Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please remember to friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, go to davidfeldmanshow.com to do all your Amazon shopping. And for only $5 a month or more, depending on how much you want to give, you can become a monthly subscriber and gain access to all our premium content. We have a YouTube channel. It's only audio so far, but I'd like you to subscribe to it. I've mentioned this before on the show. The YouTube channel is our show as a YouTube video. Very easy to share, to post on Twitter and Facebook. On today's show, it's all great comedy writers. Vic Berger from Super Deluxe. Vic Berger is more than a comedian. He is a surreal video artist whose YouTube page you just have to go to, or go to the Super Deluxe YouTube page and watch his work. On today's show, he talks about getting discovered by Tim and Eric and how he's able to take what appears to be a simple video clip and turn it into a bizarre truth, a truth that is more true than what the clip originally was. The Steve Harvey having a meltdown on Family Feud video is beyond genius. Go see his work. It's amazing. We're also joined by one of my heroes, Dr. Katz. Jonathan Katz joins us via Skype for a meandering conversation about daughters, wives, and joke writing. Speaking of joke writers, Steve Young is back. Steve is a comedy writing legend. We've talked about him on the show countless times. Just, you know, David Letterman show. He wrote for David Letterman since the beginning. He is a comedy genius. We plug a gig on today's show that he did earlier in the week. We were going to originally run this conversation with him on our Tuesday drop, but because of the Muslim ban and the horror show coming out of Washington, D.C., I just felt we had to play it today on Friday. So we're plugging a gig he already did. Steve is the co-author, along with Sport Murphy, of Everything's Coming Up Prophets, The Golden Age of Industrial Musicals. It's an illustrated history of musicals written for company conventions and sales meetings. It's a book. It's soon to be a documentary. And it's also a traveling show. And that's the gig that Steve did in Brooklyn earlier this week, which was sold out. He didn't need to plug it on my show. Also, Tony Zarrett, very brilliant young comedy writer, joins us. It's going to be a light show. So there's good news. There's good news. People are making their voices heard. I'm a broken record. I talk about fivecalls.org all the time. The number 5calls.org. Simplify your life. Turn off the TV. Turn off CNN. Turn off MSNBC. You need a digital detox. You need a television detox. Go buy a hard copy of the Washington Post or the New York Times or the Nation magazine or the Progressive magazine or your local newspaper. Hold paper in your hands. Get off the computer, because you're just constantly inundated and distracted. A digital detox, 3 times a day. Go 4 hours without your phone on. Go 4 hours each day without looking at your computer. Read a book off paper. Read the newspaper off paper. It allows your brain to focus for long stretches of time without interruptions. You know, there's a form of PTSD going on when you're trying to focus, to relax, just read, and then all of a sudden, boop, 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 you know, a message, a phone call. After a while, your lizard brain starts shooting adrenaline because you just never know when you're going to be getting an alert about another crazy Trump decision. Focus, take a deep breath, and go to 5calls.org. This is a legal uprising that's going on in our country. There's been an awakening. This is bigger than the Tea Party. Echoes of Occupy Wall Street. People know what they want, and they're making their voices heard. 5calls.org. And there's been good news. Uber, very controversial company. We did a story about Uber on our show about 2 years ago. The episode is entitled Uber Sucks. Travis Kalanick is the immigrant owner of Uber. It's still a private company. They're about to go public. The chief executive of Uber, Travis Kalanick, met with Donald Trump in December, along with all the other Silicon Valley tools, and he agreed to sit on Donald Trump's Economic Advisory Council. But then the immigration order came down Friday, where Americans are going to have a moratorium on accepting refugees from seven Muslim-majority countries. And protests broke out at JFK Airport over the weekend. The taxis went on strike. Uber responded by getting rid of surge pricing. Surge pricing at Uber is no matter who picks you up, the driver's name Surge. No, surge pricing, if you don't use Uber, when there's a big demand for cars, they triple, quadruple the prices. Uber unfairly got accused of dropping surge pricing to capitalize on the taxi strike that was going on to protest Trump's decision to ban Muslims from seven countries. In all fairness to Uber, they dropped the surge pricing after the taxi drivers ended their strike and went back to work. It was only a one-hour strike. It was on Saturday. It was just a one-hour strike. But people overreacted. People are gunning for Uber, and rightfully so. They play hardball. They do whatever they want. They introduce driverless cars in San Francisco without any permission from the city council. They act like Donald Trump. Build the building with the violations and then pay the fines later. That's how Uber thinks, and that's how Donald Trump thinks. Well, there was a backlash to Uber, and 200,000 customers deleted their accounts after Lyft donated $1 million to the ACLU, and the New York Taxi Workers Alliance sent emails to various news organizations accusing Uber of being in bed with Donald Trump. And a protest, the New York Taxi Workers Alliance organized a protest in front of Uber's New York office out in Queens. Well, there was a meeting on Tuesday that Travis Kalanick had with the Uber employees, and he said, any questions? And two employees raised their hand, and they both said, why don't you quit Donald Trump's Economic Council? And on Thursday, yesterday, Travis Kalanick quit. He quit Donald Trump's Economic Council. Elon Musk, an immigrant, sits on it. He's the founder of Tesla and SpaceX. And Mary Barra of General Motors also sits on the president's economic advisory team. GM, as you know, has had a lot of problems with the Obama Justice Department with their ignition switches. I'm sure with Mary Barra of GM sitting on Donald Trump's economic advisory team, she expects special treatment from the Justice Department, which she was not getting from the Obama administration. 200,000 apps, 200,000 Uber apps were deleted because Uber had a whiff of collaboration with the Trump administration. So they can't count our votes, but they can count our money. If you want to take back this republic, you have to vote, but you also have to watch where you spend your money. You got to keep an eye on where your money goes. Knowing that Elon Musk is normalizing Donald Trump by sitting on his economic advisory team, I'm not buying any rockets from SpaceX. I refuse to go into outer space using any of Elon Musk's engines. The Tesla, we have to ask ourselves, if you can afford a Tesla, would you buy it, knowing that Elon Musk has normalized Donald Trump? Will you buy a GM car, knowing that Mary Barra is normalizing Donald Trump? You cannot give Donald Trump and Steve Bannon any quarter. We have to legally stand up to these fascists. We have to challenge them. The only way to stand up to them is by going after the one thing they care about, money. They only care about money. Be careful how you spend your money. Pay attention to who's in bed with Donald Trump. Matthew McConaughey just gave an interview in London where he said, you know, we have to hug Donald Trump. That's not all right, all right, all right. You know, Matthew McConaughey, you think it's okay that we have to give Donald Trump some time and give him a hug? No, you have to punish fascists by voting, by calling your congressman, and making sure you're not supporting the collaborators. Matthew McConaughey is a collaborator. If he says we have to hug Donald Trump, he's a collaborator. If Mary Barra of General Motors meets with Donald Trump and sits on his economic advisory team, she's a collaborator. And they'll always say, well, you know, we want a seat at the table because on the inside, we can really, if you get a seat at the table, on the inside, we can really affect change. No, no, you don't sit at that table. Nobody sits at that table. Nobody. There's a big white tie charity ball tomorrow, Saturday, at Mar-a-Lago. That's the Palm Beach club that Donald Trump bought in the 80s. They just raised the dues to $200,000. In order to join now, you have to pony up $200,000 to join Mar-a-Lago. Trump, who lost the popular vote by 3 million, is flying down to Mar-a-Lago this weekend. And while he's there, the American Red Cross will be holding their annual fundraising gala. It's a white tie charity ball to raise money for the Red Cross. Good organization, right? That's what you think. It's the first charity that everybody goes to when you think of giving money to a charity. Oh, let's give to the Red Cross. Elizabeth Penniman, she's the Red Cross's vice president of communication. She would not come to the phone today. We called. I couldn't get her on the line. She said that the event at Mar-a-Lago had been booked many, many, many months in advance. And she was asked, well, if you knew that Donald Trump had gotten elected president, would you still hold the event at Mar-a-Lago? And she said, well, we're not political. We're just trying to raise money to help those affected by disasters and people who need blood. And we want to support our military and their families and provide international humanitarian aid. That's what she said. She said the Red Cross is all about providing international humanitarian aid. Meanwhile, while they're busy raising money to provide international humanitarian aid, they're holding a ball, a charity ball at Mar-a-Lago, 1 week after Donald Trump said there's going to be a 120-day ban on Muslim refugees from seven countries. There's going to be a ban on their coming into this country. But the Red Cross normalizes Mar-a-Lago. They are pretty much giving their imprimatur, their stamp of approval to Mar-a-Lago, to Donald Trump, by holding this event at his showcase resort, Mar-a-Lago. Not only is the Red Cross making Donald Trump look benevolent by holding the event at Mar-a-Lago, they are feathering his nest. The Red Cross is not getting Mar-a-Lago for free. Donald Trump isn't donating Mar-a-Lago. According to the Associated Press, the event is going to raise $925,000. Well, that's a lot of money, right? You're pulling in a lot of money for one day's event. But Mar-a-Lago is charging them $400,000 to put it on. Okay? So do the math. What's $925,000 minus $400,000? What is it? It's $525,000, I believe, right? They're raising $925,000. It costs $400,000 to put it on. They're hiring Mar-a-Lago's chefs, their waiters, the band, the rental fees for the room. Donald Trump is not donating that $400,000. He's charging the Red Cross $400,000 because he sees charity as a way to make money, which is why the Trump Foundation, the money donated to the Trump Foundation was used to hire somebody to do a 9-foot portrait of our fearless leader. The Red Cross does not spend your money properly. In fact, my friend Robin Adams found this for me. It's an article from the Washington Post from March 4th, 2006. The headline, Red Cross gave ousted executive $780,000 deal. Former Red Cross chief executive Marcia J. Evans received a severance package valued at about $780,000 after she was fired in December of 2005. Bernadine Healy was the chief executive of Red Cross from 1991 and was forced out in 2001. She had been receiving a $2 million a year salary plus a severance package. $2 million a year to run Red Cross. If you're making $2 million a year, you know, you get fired. You're always thinking about your next job. Of course you would hold the event at Mar-a-Lago and pay out $400,000 to put it on, because that tells the plutocrats who are showing up for this black tie event that you play ball. The money's getting spread around. It's not going to where it's needed. It's going into the pockets of people like Donald Trump. The money is getting moved around. That's the idea when you work for these big charities. $2 million a year is a lot of money for anybody to be paid, especially an organization that requires donations. Go to Charity Navigator, charitynavigator.org. These are the 10 highly rated charities with low paid CEOs. Okay? Charity Navigator says the median compensation for all registered charities is $150,000 a year. It's a charity. You're not supposed to get rich off a charity. When I donate money to a charity, it's not supposed to go to the executives. And people say, well, you know, how are you going to get a great executive if you don't pay them what they're worth? You know what? There are people who will do the job for $150,000. You don't need $2 million to do the Lord's work. If you need $2 million to do the Lord's work, you're not doing the Lord's work. The top 10 highly rated charities with low paid CEOs are the Gospel Mission. That's number one. It pays its CEO $50,000. Disciple Makers, Global Health Ministries, Nepal Youth Foundation, House of Bread, Food Bank of the Albemarle, United Way of Southern Chautauqua County, North Country Food Bank Incorporated, Valley Outreach, International Children's Fund. International Children's Fund, they pay their CEO $63,000. CharityNavigator.org. Before you give money to any group, go to CharityNavigator.org to make sure you're giving money to the right charities. Make sure the charity you're giving to doesn't pay its CEO, their chief executive, $2 million a year like they paid Bernadine Healy, who was fired in 2001. I don't know what they pay the current CEO of Red Cross, but if they were paying Bernadine Healy $2 million a year in 2001, I bet it's double. I bet it's a lot more. If you go to charitynavigator.org to look for charities with perfect scores, you won't see, you will not see the Red Cross. Under international, nope, Child Aid, Direct Relief, Kids Alive International, Meds and Food for Kids, Palestine Children's Relief Fund, Houston Food Bank, nope, don't see the Red Cross. I see the Red Cross going to Mar-a-Lago. I see the Red Cross holding a big party at Mar-a-Lago this Saturday, where they're going to spend $400,000 to raise $925,000. I see them giving a stamp of approval to Donald Trump, who is banning Muslims from entering this country, when the Red Cross is all about providing international humanitarian aid, and yet they're in bed with Donald Trump. You have to punish these people. You can't allow this. You can't sit back and allow this. You have to give to other charities. And it's not good enough that you give to other charities. You need to let the Red Cross know. When you write the check to another charity, you have to send a note to the Red Cross and say, because you're doing business with Donald Trump, Because you gave him your stamp of approval, I am no longer donating money to the Red Cross. The Red Cross has a brand. It's a brand. It's the name you always go to. So we all, everybody donates to the Red Cross first. Article in the New York Times about how to help the Syrian refugees. Who do you give your money to? Well, the New York Times, about 7 months ago, and they really do vet charities. These are the charities that they recommended. Hope for Syria, Catholic Relief Services, Islamic Relief USA, Interaction, International Rescue Committee, Oxfam America, Doctors Without Borders. I don't see the Red Cross here. I see the International Rescue Committee. I see Save the Children. I see the World Food Program. I don't see the Red Cross in this list of reputable charities to save the refugees. 60 million people around the world were displaced from their homes in 2015 due to war, persecution. It's the largest number of refugees since World War II. The Syrians, 11 million Syrians have been displaced. You know, that picture of the three-year-old Syrian boy dead on the Turkish beach in September of last year. We remember that. But it's not just him. And I don't mean there are other refugees who died. I mean, in his family, that boy's father lost another son and his wife when they crossed the Mediterranean into Greece to get away from Syria. Right now in Lebanon, at least a quarter, maybe a third of Lebanon's population is Syrian refugees. The United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees say that 4.4 million Syrians have had to leave Syria, while 6.5 million Syrians have just been displaced from their home and are living somewhere else in Syria. This is a crisis, a magnitude that's almost incomprehensible. And what does America do? We take 10,000 refugees. We take 10,000 Syrian refugees. And then this president is installed who says, we're not taking anybody. We're not taking, he gets into a fight with the Prime Minister of Australia over the weekend. We're not taking anybody. This is grotesque. And for the American Red Cross, which says that it's dedicated to international humanitarian aid, for them, a week after this travel ban has been announced, for them to stage this ball at Mar-a-Lago and spend $400,000 to raise $925,000, the math isn't there to justify that. ProPublica has an article about the Red Cross. The Red Cross, which Saturday is holding this big event at Mar-a-Lago. The Red Cross, according to ProPublica, I'll link to this on my website. ProPublica wrote a piece with NPR, speaking of people who waste donations. But ProPublica is a good organization. ProPublica, here's the headline from this article. How the Red Cross raised $500 million for Haiti and built, how many homes do you think they built for $500 million? 6 homes. You may not remember, but back in 2011, there was a massive earthquake in Haiti. The Red Cross received a flood of donations, $500 million. The leader of the Red Cross said, we are on this and we are going to save the people of Haiti, collected $500 million. And according to ProPublica, they squandered all the money and lied about it. According to ProPublica, the Red Cross claimed that it provided homes to more than 130,000 Haitians. That's what they told us. The investigation by ProPublica shows they only built 6 homes. ProPublica goes on to say that it's part of a larger problem, that it's not just Haiti, that they botched delivery of aid after Superstorm Sandy. Even though it's the charity of choice for most Americans and corporations, they are unable to take that money and distribute what's necessary after a disaster. The Red Cross, they need to be put on notice. If you give money to the Red Cross instead of the other charities I'm recommending through the New York Times or Charity Navigator, you are throwing your money away. I recommend that you go to charitynavigator.org. If you, God willing, have any money to give, make sure you go to charitynavigator.org and give your money, and then send a note to the Red Cross telling them that you gave to, I don't know, Doctors Without Borders because of the Red Cross doing business, and I do mean business, with Donald Trump. There is a protest outside the gates of Mar-a-Lago for Saturday. It's called March to Mar-a-Lago for Humanity. 1,000 people say they plan to attend the march. There's a Facebook page if you want to find out more information about the protest. The Facebook page is called March to Mar-a-Lago for Humanity. And that protest is this Saturday, tomorrow, outside Mar-a-Lago. And as the Red Cross pulls up and the 500 plutocrats show up, you will make your voice heard and shame these people, as well they should be. Fivecalls.org, the number 5calls.org. Call your congressman, call your congresswoman, call your senator, and 5calls.org will tell you what to say and who to call. You type in your zip code, and it tells you who your congressperson is, who your senator is. They give you 5 scripts, and you call your congressperson, senator, takes 1 minute. And if you've been following this, you know that the staffers, their ears are ringing. We're doing good. We're doing good. Well, I was going to talk about this raid that Steve Bannon ordered 5 days into his presidency that left a Navy SEAL dead and an 8-year-old American girl was killed in the raid. Nobody's really talking about the 8-year-old girl, and I just want to mention who she is. This was a disaster. A Navy SEAL Team 6 did a raid in Yemen. It was 5 days into the Trump presidency. The Obama administration was reluctant to go through with this plan because the last time they tried an operation in Yemen was in December of 2014. SEAL Team 6 stormed southern Yemen to free an American photojournalist who was being held hostage by Al-Qaeda. But the raid was a failure. The kidnappers killed the journalist and a South African who was being held with them. So the Obama administration was a little reluctant to go through with this mission, but Steve Bannon was salivating to do something. They went in. Chief Petty Officer William Owens died. A $75 million aircraft had to be destroyed because it had been shot down. This is the story that is just getting buried. We heard that an 8-year-old girl had been killed in the raid. But they're really not telling us that she is the daughter of Anwar al-Awlaki. He is the American-born al-Qaeda leader who President Obama killed in 2011 with a drone strike. This is an extrajudicial killing of an American citizen. I believe they also killed his son later. Somehow, now, the 8-year-old daughter of Anwar al-Awlaki was killed in this failed strike. They killed an 8-year-old American girl. Now, this was not a successful raid. Everything that could have gone wrong went wrong. This was a raid that the Obama administration did not think was a good idea. And yet, afterwards, Donald Trump said it was a tremendous success, that this raid that was approved of by Steve Bannon and Jared Kushner and Defense Secretary Jim Mattis. On Sunday, Trump said this was his first counterterrorism operation. He said it was a tremendous success. He claimed that SEAL Team 6 captured important intelligence that will assist the U.S. in preventing terrorism against its citizens and people around the world. But we're hearing otherwise. The reason I mention this, there are 2 reasons. One is we killed an 8-year-old American citizen who is the daughter of American-born al-Qaeda leader who we killed without a trial. We also killed the American son of Anwar al-Awlaki. Was that an accident? Or did they intentionally kill the daughter of this al-Qaeda leader? That's the first thing. Secondly, this was not a successful operation. And Trump is lying to us and saying it was a success. We're learning otherwise. When his approval dips even further, he's going to take us to war. And I said this after the inauguration. When the president looks at aerial photos of his inauguration and says, there were more people at my inauguration than there were at President Obama's, these photos from the Park Service are lies. These photos from the press are lies. When the president lies over little things, like how many people showed up to his inauguration, he's going to lie on the much more important things, like SEAL Team 6 raids in Yemen that didn't go well. There's going to come a time in the not too distant future when Donald Trump is going to address America from the Oval Office, telling us why we need to commit troops somewhere, someplace. Are you willing to believe him? Can you trust him to send your child into battle? And that's why I say bring back the draft. Because as long as American citizens don't have skin in the game, we will believe our commander-in-chief, even though we know he's a liar. As long as it's not our children being victimized by not just the lies, but the incompetence, we will give Donald Trump a chance when he addresses us from the Oval Office and tells us it's time to go to war. Are you going to let him take us to war? Are you? Are you going to believe him? Bring back the draft. Let's have some fun.
You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.